Welcome to Church Online. So glad that you're joining us here today.
Yes, we have exciting things in store for you today. We're going to have communion together. So you can grab something when we have that moment. And Pastor Will Green will be preaching, and that's going to be a cracker of a message.
Come on. And right now, we're going to just take some time to worship together. So why don't you join the team as we worship?
Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness, you have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but sing, yeah. Faithful you are,
amen.
Faithful forever you will be,
yeah.
Faithful you are,
oh.
'Cause all your promises are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. Savior, you have brought me near. You pulled me from the ashes. You have broken every curse. Oh, blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free.
Yeah,
Lord.
Stand upon your promises.
And I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. And I will rest,
yeah,
in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. And I will rest in your promises. My confidence, oh, is your faithfulness. And I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. Oh, faithful you are.
We're going to take this moment right now to pray for you, our church family. Why don't you pray with me? Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for every single person who is watching right now. I thank you, Lord, for your presence with them. I thank you, God, that you are Emmanuel. You are God with us. I thank you that you walk with us each and every day. And Lord, I just pray for a sense of your peace and your presence with each person, and that they would know your hand upon them and your great delight and your great love for them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. We're going to come around our time of our offering right now, as we do regularly in our services. I just want to encourage you, this is a moment of worship. And for me, I often switch off sometimes in this moment, actually, because for me, I automatically do my giving. It just happens automatically. The bank kind of does it. But I have to tell myself, this is actually an important moment. A moment where I actually have to switch on, where I have to worship God. You know, it says in Psalm 100, it says, worship the Lord with gladness, come before him with joyful songs. So right now, as we worship him, I encourage you, come before him with gladness, come before him joyfully as you bring your offering. Connect this moment where maybe you've made a bank transaction at another time. Connect this moment right now with that moment. So let me pray for you. Lord God, I just thank you for those who are giving right now. I pray you would be with them, that you would bless them, Lord God, and that they would know that you are God, and they would joyfully worship you. In your name, amen.
Amen.
To participate in this moment of giving, you can head to c3churchride.com.au/give or download the church app and head to the giving tab at the bottom of the screen. Kids Church happens every week on site at Saturday night and Sunday morning services, and Kids Online is available on demand anytime. Full House Youth is for those in school years 6 to 12 on every Friday night from 7 to 9pm during the school term.
We come to this beautiful time of communion together, and Jesus instructed us to do this in remembrance of him. At this time, we connect our hearts to this moment and to each other, and we do remember. We remember that Jesus loves us deeply. We remember that Jesus blessed those when he was on this earth. He blessed those around him. He healed them. He rose people from the dead. He was our amazing Savior. But mostly we remember that Jesus stretched out his arms on that cross, that he willingly took our place. He paid the penalty of our sin. Jesus defeated death and defeated sin so that we could be saved. Because of this, our hearts are filled with joy. We also remember that Jesus appeared, he defeated death and rose again. For a period of 40 days, he appeared to his disciples. He is the risen Christ. And we know that Jesus went to heaven and will return. We know that Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father and that he is our intercessor. We come to this moment of deep remembrance and deep gratitude. With deep gratitude, we know that Jesus saved us. And so we come to this time with this little piece of bread that represents Jesus' body that he willingly laid down for us and his blood that he shed for us. Because of this, we are saved. So let us join together in thanksgiving as we honour our wonderful Jesus. Lord Jesus, we thank you for all that you have done for us. We thank you that you saved us. We thank you, Lord, that you are our good shepherd. Lord, we bless you and praise you with all of our hearts. We remember all that you have done, and our hearts are filled with gratitude and your peace. We thank you. We bless you. Amen.
In the darkest Hey, welcome to another message in our follower series. My name's Will, and it's such a privilege to be with you today, wherever you are watching this. We have been doing this series called Follower because, you know, we want to be real followers of Jesus, not just fans of Jesus. There's plenty of people who like the teaching of Jesus or the principles of Jesus or the idea of Jesus. But Jesus has not invited us to be a fan of him. He's invited us to be a follower of him. And fans of Jesus will not have their lives changed by Jesus, but followers will. And fans of Jesus won't see the work of God in the world around them. They won't see God doing this incredible transformative work around them, but followers of Jesus will. And what the world needs is more followers of Jesus, not just fans of Jesus, not just people who, you know, attend church once a week and go on with their lives, but people who are committed to a lifelong daily pursuit of Jesus. And so we've been looking at all sorts of things. We've been talking about following Jesus as our teacher. We've been talking about following Jesus as our Lord, as our King. We've talked about all these things, but today I want to talk about following Jesus as our Savior. And to be a follower of Jesus, you need to come to this place where you acknowledge that Jesus is your Savior, that you need saving, and Jesus is the one who will do it. And we're going to look at Matthew chapter 1, verse 18 to 23. This is sort of early on in the story of the life of Jesus. In fact, you've probably heard this story read around Christmas time. I've sort of called it a Christmas verse in my mind. And so it seems like a bit of a strange place to start. But I want to look at this scripture and just unpack it a little bit as we talk about following Jesus as our Savior. So here we go. Matthew chapter 1. Verse 20, just to give you a bit of a picture of what's going on, is that Joseph is this man engaged to a woman, Mary, and Mary has been found to be pregnant, and it's not Joseph's, okay? So Joseph has it in his mind to divorce her or break up this engagement quietly because he doesn't want to disgrace her, but he's also like, that's not my baby, something's gone wrong here, and so we're done. But then, this is what it says, after he'd considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. You know, why Jesus? Why did Jesus come? Why did Jesus live and die on the cross and rise again? And why do millions of people across the earth to this day still follow Jesus? Like, why Jesus? What's going on here? Well, this angel is saying to Joseph and is saying to every reader of this gospel and is saying to you and I that Jesus came to fulfill what the Lord had said, what the Lord had promised, and Jesus came to save his people from their sins. Jesus came as a savior. So let's just unpack this a little bit. The angel, I mean, at the moment, at the time of recording, my wife is expecting, and it would be so awesome if an angel just appeared to me and said, give them this name. I think that would make the whole name choosing situation a lot easier. But here, this angel is saying, hey, the name that God has chosen for this child is Jesus. Give him the name Jesus. Now, a baby name is sort of a big deal for anyone, but in particular in the Bible, people's names are important. Sometimes people in the Bible give names to their children that are sort of aspirational names, or they're named after an important person in the history of God's people, or they're named after what the parents hope they will be like. Or let me give you an example. It'd be like if I named my son 99 ATAR, or it'd be like if I named my son, Doctor as a first name. This is Dr. Green, or if I named, my daughter, this is world record breaking sprinter Green. Like it's these big aspirational names that I hope you live up to become what I have named you. Sometimes names in scripture are prophetic. as in God gives this person this name, and their name and their life is a statement from God to the world around them. And right here, God has chosen the name Jesus. Give him the name Jesus. Now, Jesus is another form of the name Joshua, which means the Lord saves or Yahweh saves. And in the history of the Jewish people, of the Israelites, Joshua was an important guy. Joshua, the Lord saves. This guy was important. He was the promised land pioneer. Joshua was the guy who led God's people out of desert wandering. So the Israelites had been slaves in Egypt. God delivered them out of Egypt through the leadership of a man called Moses. And then after Moses came Joshua, who led them out of the wilderness into the promised land. And so Joshua was this promised land pioneer. He led God's people out of this wandering former slavery into freedom. Unfortunately, though, for God's people is that Joshua could never fully deliver God's people from their biggest problem. And wherever God's people went, this problem followed them. It was sin. And sin just wrecked everything. Wherever they went, sin corrupted everything. Sin ruined everything. They were like, if we can just get in the promised land, everything will be fine. And sin followed them and everything was ruined. And they're like, well, if we can just have a king, develop a political system for our people, everything will be fine. And they have a king and of course sin wrecks it. And they just go through these ups and downs where sin continually follows them and they're never fully free of sin. They had this impartial freedom. But now here comes Jesus, this next Joshua, who's not just going to deliver them merely out of one geographical location into another. Jesus himself is going to deliver the people from their greatest problem, the problem of every human heart, my biggest problem and your biggest problem. The problem of sin. And so the angel says, give him the name Jesus because he will save. No man, no human effort, a substitute could never fully deliver the people from sin. A substitute can never do what only God can do. And you know, at the moment, while we're filming this, we're about to have our youth camp. As a church, it's just an incredible weekend where the teenagers will all go away and have a great time and meet with God and have their life transformed. I know it. And I've been to many camps myself. And time again at these youth camps, we have seen God do what only God can do. Because no human can truly change someone's heart. I've seen people at youth camp and it doesn't matter how well I preach or how hard I convince or how clever I am or all the evidence that I present to someone, I cannot make a single person believe in God. I cannot melt a hard heart. I cannot change someone's mind. But I have seen at camp teenagers come who are hard-hearted towards God, don't believe him at all, are full of doubts and full of things going on. And yet I have seen God break in their life and I have seen God change their heart where they move from being on the back row, arms folded, to by the last day being up the front on their knees, crying like tears because God has changed their heart in such a deep and profound way. Only God can do that. I've seen people healed in a car park. Only God can do that. We see all sorts of things at youth camp, but the same is true right here and right now, wherever you are. I want to encourage you that perhaps there are things in your life which you have tried to get at with your best effort, with your best striving, and maybe you've read books and attended courses and tried new habits and tried all these different things. But if you're really honest with yourself, the deep problems of your heart, you have not been able to reach or change. And it's like Paul says in the Bible, he says, the things I don't want to do, I keep doing them. And the things I do want to do that I should do, I don't do them. Who will deliver me from this body of sin? Well, thanks be to Jesus. Jesus is the one who saves us from our sin. And I want to encourage you that maybe you've tried and tried and tried again. I want to tell you that only God can truly touch your heart. Only Jesus Christ can save you from sin. Only Jesus Christ can truly transform your heart. And he's with you right here. wherever you are right now, he is with you right here. And Jesus saved yesterday. He can save today. He can save tomorrow. And he can truly transform your life. Jesus is our Savior. And so, so the angel says, he will save his people from their sins. Not another person, not a messenger, not a Joshua, not a Moses, but Jesus, fully man and fully God. God himself will deliver his people from their sins. And that's also an interesting line right there. The angel says, his people. Now, Joseph would have heard this phrase, his people. Now, Joseph being Jewish and Joseph growing up, understanding that God's chosen people were the nation of Israel, the one family that God was doing work in, and God was, these were his people. And these were his chosen people that he was gonna bless the whole world through. So Joseph listening to his people is hearing this as exclusively Jewish, that he will come to save his people, the Jews, from their sins. But the good news is that God in his greatness and his kindness was not sending Jesus only to save the Jews, but to save the world, those Jew and Gentile. And this is so beautiful. So we have to like ask the question, who are his people? Because in John, it says, to those who believed in him, he gave the right to become children of God, not just, of natural descent or ancestry, or not just a child born because parents wanted to have a child, but children of God, those who believe. Now, anyone who believes in Jesus is now part of the people of God. We are adopted in. Now, it's so important to remember that following Jesus as our Savior, we just have to grasp this, that salvation is personal. Jesus has saved me and Jesus can save you. It's immensely personal, but it is also communal. We are saved into a people, and the grace we have received, the forgiveness we have received, we now also have to extend it to those around us. So we cannot have this sort of mindset that says, I'm better than everyone else. No, we actually have to have grace and love to those who are in the body of Christ, that he saved them and he saved me. He forgave them and he forgave me. There is no room for tribalism. There is no room for withholding grace. But those of us who have been saved and are in the body of Christ are now called to extend this same grace and love which we have received, to forgive those around us, to overlook offenses, to assume the best, to believe the best, to embrace his people because he has embraced us. And it says he will save his people from their sins. And this is what it's all about. You know, you can be a fan of Jesus and you can attend church and you can pray like, Jesus, would you bless this part of my life? Or Jesus, would you help this part of my life? Sometimes people like being around church and they like the message of Jesus because it feels like, oh, you know, this is this really great thing. It's so hopeful and positive. And if we're not careful, we can start to treat Jesus like the genie who grants wishes, like Jesus died on the cross so he could grant all our wishes. We say, Jesus, would you bless this? Jesus, would you help me with this? Now, of course, he can help us in these areas. He loves us. He loves giving good gifts to his children. But the truth is this, that he's come to save us from our sins. Now, he may not answer some of those prayers. Lord, bless this. Give me that. Help me with this. Lord, I need this. I need that. He may not answer those prayers, or it may seem like he's not, but he will always answer this prayer. Lord, forgive me for my sin. Forgive me for my sin. And I want to encourage you, do not follow Jesus because of some sort of perceived benefit to your life. Follow Jesus because he is the only one who can forgive you for your sin. He is the only one who can create in you a new heart, a pure heart. He is the only one. I love that old hymn. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And right now, I want to give you this invitation to receive forgiveness for your sin. If that's you right now, I'd just love to pray for you. Open up your heart and receive him. Put your faith in him right now. So Lord, I thank you for this person watching. I thank you, Jesus, that there is no sin too great that you cannot forgive. There is no sin too small that is out of your reach. But Jesus, you who knew no sin became our sin. Lord, this person watching right now, you took every single sin. Lord, you took it all on yourself. And I thank you, Jesus, that you died and you rose again so they could be forgiven. So Lord, I pray that you would forgive them of their sin, make them a new creation, fill them with your spirit, and help them to follow you from this moment. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, we want to help you follow Jesus every day of your life. So please reach out to us so we can help you. We can pray for you. We can connect you into this church or wherever you are at church. And we're praying for you every day. We love you. God bless you. See you again soon.
Hey, thank you so much for joining us today for Church Online. What a cracker of a message from Pastor Will in our follower series. I just want to encourage you to come to church again. We love having you here, whether you want to join us again online or you're welcome to join us on site at 89 Blackstone Road in Ryde, Sydney, Australia. We would love to see you.
Yes, and if you want to make contact with anyone in the office, we'd love to hear from you, so you can always call us at church or come into the building. We pray you have a great week. We'll see you next time.